Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. I am Reesha and this is For the Love of Classics. Today's video is going to be a reading wrap-up. I have read two books this year so far. Both of these authors were new to me. One of these books is a non-fiction and the other one was written by a Pakistani-American writer. So the first book which I'm going to talk about today is The Butchering Art by Lindsey Fitzharris. This piece of non-fiction is written about the history of Victorian medicine. I have rated this book a 5 out of 5 stars. I absolutely loved it and I'm so glad I read it. It was not a very long book. It was just 250 pages long and it was such a page turner. I could not sleep at night because I wanted to finish a chapter before I went to bed. Fitzharris wrote this story in such a captivating manner. It's a true story about how Joseph Lister changed the art of surgery. He changed surgery from what was back then known as a butchering art to the modern medicine we know today. Now, this book is not for the weak-hearted. There are some stories in here which are gruesome. There are bits of very gruesome details in here. It's not because Fitzharris was trying to make the book more gory and brutal, but the truth is that medicine back then was actually, you know, pretty bad. People did not know germs existed, so there was no concept of cleaning your hands before starting a surgery. There was no concept of making sure the instruments used during the surgery were clean. The patient wasn't properly prepped or cleaned up before the surgery. The surgeons went from one surgery to the next without washing their hands. So they took the blood, the germs from the first patient to the second patient, and they actually thought that, you know, they were very good, very quick. They were doing surgeries in less than a minute because there was no anesthesia back then. And that just, I mean, I knew that anesthesia wasn't invented till recent times, but even thinking about it now, like, people were having knee amputations and arm amputations and leg amputations without any anesthesia. I'm a medical practitioner myself. I have seen how amputations are done, and even thinking about the patient being conscious while an amputation is being performed is just insane. So this book basically talks about two major innovations in the field of medicine. The first one was the introduction of anesthesia, and the second one was the concept of antisepsis. In the first chapter of this book, we see that chloroform is being introduced, and Joseph Lister was a medical student at the time. He saw the first surgery which was done using chloroform, and in the last chapter of this book we see how the concept of antisepsis is finally settling in. So these are two landmark events in the history of medicine, and this book covers the span of how it went from the first point to the second point. It actually took Joseph Lister ages to convince his colleagues, to convince the medical community at the time that germs existed. Because even though the microscope was invented back then, it wasn't as powerful. It wasn't able to see very minute organisms. I mean, I could go on about this book forever because I was fascinated by it. The core of the book is that Joseph Lister had to struggle a lot to convince everyone of what he believed in, and the way Lindsey Fitzharris told that story is absolutely amazing. I wish she could write about all the major events which took place during the history of medicine, because there's no account of that anywhere. I never knew when chloroform was invented. I didn't understand when antisepsis was brought into medical practice. And she's talking about the medical bodies which actually exist today and how they were reluctant to change, how they were making fun of Lister, how there was a lot of political drama going on between the surgical societies in London, in Edinburgh, in Glasgow. It's actually fascinating to note that the hospitals in Scotland pioneered in the methods of antisepsis because they listened to Joseph Lister. He was a teacher there and he inspired the surgeons and his students there to start using the methods of antisepsis. While the surgeons in London were very old school and the condition of hospitals in London was barbaric, there was no concept of cleanliness. And this is where Fitzharris doesn't hesitate to give you the details of how the hospitals in London were back then. I have read so many novels about Victorian era, right? I read classics all the time, and I know that a lot of people were dying back then in those books, but I never got a glimpse inside the hospitals at the time because none of the characters in the books went to a hospital. And I understand why people were avoiding going to hospitals, because if you went to a hospital back then, you didn't come out of it because you died either of the surgical procedure or you died from the infection after the surgery. And that's because they didn't understand that wounds needed cleaning. They did not understand that pus did not mean that the wound was healing. In fact, it meant that it was getting worse. And that's one thing, you know, Joseph Lister tried to fight for. He tried to make sure that the surgeons understood what they were doing with the wounds was not right. I got to learn a lot about medical history from this book. I've put in a lot of these orange tabs, and this is where there are gruesome details. So you'll notice that there is a lot of that in the first half of the book, because that's when even Joseph Lister wasn't sure what was causing the infections. There are a lot of details about some really weird stuff. I've marked these parts because these parts were shocking to me as well. I knew there was no anesthesia back then, but I did not know that surgeons had to be really powerful so that they could, you know, hold the patient. When he was trying to run away from the operation theater, surgery was considered a butchering art. It wasn't considered like a science or something you have to be very fine with. And when I think about surgeons today, I know the work they do is very detailed, very intricate and meticulous. So the change from this to what I know surgery to be today is pretty huge. In the first few chapters, we see Joseph Lister as a medical student, so we see a lot of dissection halls, and we see how a lot of medical students actually died because they cut themselves while dissecting and they got infected and, you know, basically died from that infection. Imagine 50% of the students in a medical school just dying during the medical school. That's insane. And that's pretty much what was happening in the Victorian era. There are different types of surgeries being done in this book. The most common surgery being performed back then was amputation, but there was also a lot of tumor removal. There was no chemotherapy back then, right? So the only option they had was surgical removal of the tumor. And in one part, we see that a close family member of Joseph Lister has a tumor, and Joseph Lister basically decides to do the surgery for that family member. All the surgeons at the time refused to do the surgery because they thought there was no point, it was not going to be successful. But Lister decided to do it at his own house, on his dining table, and it was amazing to read about. So this book had a similar vibe to A Country Doctor's Notebook by Mikhail Bulgakov. They're both about medicine around the same time. Joseph Lister spent a lot of his time in Scotland and England, while this book is based in Russia. This one is set in the year 1916 to 17, while the butchering art follows the timeline of the Victorian era. There's one thing for sure, you will not be bored if you read this book. I think if you are interested in reading classics, in knowing about Victorian era, how things were back then medicine was also a very important part of that time. So I think you will definitely enjoy it. I know there are a lot of you who enjoy reading classics. So if you want to know a little bit of a background of how medicine was at the time, I think you're going to find this book fascinating. Let me know if you know about other books which are similar to this one, because I would love to read them. I think I finished this book in 10 days. There are a total of 10 or 11 chapters in the book, and I just read one chapter in a go because I couldn't put the book down once I started reading that chapter. I'm so glad I finally read it. I absolutely loved it. I enjoyed every second of it. Even though there were a lot of gruesome details, I couldn't put the book down and I wanted to share the details with someone. My husband couldn't listen to the details this book had to give about surgery back then. So that made me realize that maybe this book is not for everyone out there. There were some shocking bits in the book. I have marked 7 of those shocking parts. But otherwise, I think it was absolutely fascinating. And the reviews on the back just now make so much more sense. It was brilliant. It was gripping. It was shocking. It's the story of a real life hero, and the author has studied history from Oxford. She's currently working on her second book, which is going to be based on the history of plastic surgery. I definitely plan to read her next book as well. 5 out of 5 stars. Alright, and the next book which I want to talk about, which I read in the month of January, was An American Brat by Bapsi Sidhwa. I have talked about this book in my reading vlogs, so you can definitely check those out as well. Bapsi Sidhwa is a Pakistani-American writer. She is Parsi by faith. She has written a lot of books and is pretty well known. This was her first book which I read, and I actually really enjoyed it. I think I've given it a 3.5 star. I enjoyed the subject she decided to write about. I liked her sense of humor. She chose to tell the story of a 16-year-old girl who goes to the USA to live with her uncle for a couple of months. While she's there, she decides to stay and study there, and once she does, everything kind of changes for her. She changes gradually into this new person who is more interested in her career, who is more interested in being more independent, I guess. She cannot be the same person she used to be before. I found the book quite relatable, actually. The story was very nicely told. I think this book gave a good representation to the problems people in Pakistan face. I know I discussed some of the social problems that Firoza had to go through, but today I also want to discuss some of the political issues that were in the background of the story. The story is based in the 1970s, so that's the time that Ziaul-Haq became the president, and one of the former prime ministers, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, was hanged. I have read another book which was set around the same time frame, and that book was A Case of Exploding Mangoes by Muhammad Hanif. I absolutely loved that book, and that was sort of like historical fiction. Firoza's family is actually obsessed with the Bhutto family. Bhutto was the former prime minister who was eventually given a death sentence, and it was such a huge thing, you know. This was the prime minister of a country and he was given a death sentence. And Firoza was actually really in love with this guy. She had his posters hung up in her room even when she moved to America. And this 16-year-old girl had such strong emotions for this political figure in Pakistan, while the 16-year-olds in America had no idea about the politics of their country. And Firoza was very much interested in the politics of Pakistan, because every single person in Pakistan grows up to be interested in politics. We see the news every day. We know about what the heck is going on. Even if I don't want to know about the news, I somehow hear about it from a family member or a friend, or it's on my Facebook feed. So there's no getting away from the news. It's a very major part of our community, our society in Pakistan. And that was something which Firoza saw lacking in the American society. She felt worried and depressed when the politics were going wrong in Pakistan. She felt happier when things were going right there. Actually, there was a drastic shift from the more modern things which Bhutto brought to the country, and then Ziaul-Haq was a more fundamental leader, and they had very clashing opposing views. Firoza belonged to a family which was a religious minority in Pakistan. The new conservative leader of the country would not give them freedom to be themselves in Pakistan. I'm not sure if I have enough information to make any comments about this, but I did really enjoy reading about the whole political drama that was going on in Pakistan at the time, and how Firoza was invested in all that drama. I found a good representation of a Pakistani girl in this book. I found it relatable. And if you want to know a little bit more about Pakistan, how things work there, then you'll definitely enjoy the story. I plan to read The Crow Eaters by Bapsi Sidhwa this year, and I will definitely look into her other books as well. So that was a very lengthy and chatty book discussion about my recent reads. I had a lot of things to say about them. I felt like I wanted to discuss these books with someone, especially The Butchering Art, because I couldn't talk about that topic at home. And I'm so glad I have this outlet where I can just talk about the things I've read and what I felt about them. So let me know if you have read any of these books or do you plan to read them in the future? I'm going to keep you guys updated about my reading. Please don't forget to like this video, share a comment down below if you have anything to say about these books, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done it already. I'm going to see you all in my next video very, very soon, inshallah. Bye bye. But today I also want to talk about some of the political issues to my good I've ever done.